One of the core components of a healthy data culture is making sure that you have very good data literacy within your organization. Now, in my book, Data Culture, I talk about how important data literacy is, but I also give practical ways and examples on how you can improve data literacy. Now, one of the things that you can't do to improve data literacy is to expect everyone within the organization to go on data training courses to understand more about data. It's just not going to happen. And I've seen organizations try to roll out mass training to train the rest of the organization on how to use dashboards, how to use self-serve analytics like Power BI or Tableau. It doesn't work, okay? So in order to make a start on the journey towards lay data literacy, one of the best places I find that you can get started is to create a data glossary. Now, a data glossary is literally just a document that contains all of the KPIs and metrics that are used in your organization, talk about what they mean, show an example of what they are, and then potentially any other names that they're known by. Now, one of the things that you'll know when you start your journey on creating a data glossary is that it's quite unique to you. Now, there'll be certain metrics that are industry-wide that everybody in the industry uses, but there'll be certain metrics that are unique to your organization. So you can't really adopt or take a data glossary from someone else. You have to build your own, okay? And the reason for that is because there'll be things like gross sales or active customers that are unique to you, okay, that nobody else uses. Now, like I said, there will be some industry-wide definitions that you can use that come from maybe SaaS systems, but there will be many, many metrics that are unique to you. So make sure that the first starting point is that you create it unique to you. If you've not got a data glossary or if you've not got a template, then one of the easiest templates that you can do is create a sheet or a document with four columns, okay? Column one contains the actual metric or KPI, so you actually give it the name. Now, this metric and KPI, the name of it must be unique, okay? There should not be a duplicate of that name. So that name for that KPI metric is unique within your organization. I'll talk about later how if you do have different teams using the same name for a metric, how you resolve that. But this is the thing that you have to make sure you enforce within your data glossary, is that the name of the KPI is unique for your organization. Now, column two, put in layman's terms. So the data glossary is for the business. It's not for the data team, okay? The data team should hopefully have code and stuff that will tell you how to calculate metrics, okay? But the data glossary is a business-facing document, so it must be understood by the rest of the document. So in column two, in very simple English, in the language that the business will understand, describe what the metric is, okay? So if it's an active customer, you might describe and say, active customer is defined by the last time a customer transacted. So if they transacted in the last 28 days or 30 days, we consider them to be an active customer. If they don't transact in the last 30 days or whatever days, we don't consider them to be an active customer. See also inactive customer, lapsed customer, all that kind of stuff. Okay. So in that column two, give an example, give a description of your KPI. Okay. And like I said, it's business facing, so make sure that you use very simple non-jargon terminology to explain the metric. Column three, give an example of that metric looks like, okay? So that people get an idea of what they're expected to see in the report, okay? So if it's the time metric, make sure it's the time. If it's a number, show what the number looks like. Is it two decimal places, five decimal places? How many decimal places will you be representing the number? Give an example of it. If it's the text field, what kind of text are they expected to see? So if you're saying, this column is country, give an example of how the country would look like. Sometimes in organizations, you might have three-digit representations of country. In some organizations, they have the full spelling of the country. So make sure you give an example so people know what to expect. Then the fourth column is give any other name that this metric might be known at. Now, this could be known internally by any other metric, but also mainly externally, because a lot of the time what will happen is that the business will hear these metrics used by other organizations, or they've heard it in a conference and they want to know what they call it within their own organization. So have the fourth column that is also known as, and you can put that. So four columns: first column, the KPI metric; second column, explanation of it; third column, an example of it; and the fourth column, any other names it might be known as. Once you have the template for the data dictionary, if you ask the business to fill it in, it's not going to happen, okay? My experience, when you ask people to fill stuff in, no one does it. So you as the data team have to make a start. Now, the easiest place to make a start is in existing reports and dashboards that you have. Most businesses will already have reports and dashboards even before they have actually data teams. They will always have some form of reporting. So take those existing reports, take the KPIs and metrics, and start populating the dashboard. out. Now, what may happen is that as you go populating, you'll find issues, or you may find definitions aren't clear, or you find that no one actually knows what the definition is. So you then need to go out and do some research and find out what the definitions are, what the KPI is meant to mean, what else it's known as, any examples, and so forth. Now, when you implement the data glossary, okay, what you want to do is make sure that you've got some kind of version control, because things will change. You'll either add KPIs, take away KPIs. So therefore, if you do that in your data glossary, you must make sure that you have previous version that people can refer to, especially when you have reports. And I'll talk about later how to make this a living document, but sometimes you might send a report out a year ago and the KPIs were very different or the metrics are very different, so they need to be linking to the glossary at the time so that people can understand. But anyway, I'll talk about that later. What I want to talk about now though is actually that when you put your data glossary together, you need to achieve consensus. So let's say you've gone around and you put data glossary based on reports that you see, and you see that the marketing team has a definition of active customer. And they define active customer as anybody who's transacted on the website in the last 30 days. And then you find that the website team or the digital team has a definition of active customer. And they talk about active customer as anyone who's logged in the last 30 days. Now, both of those metrics are needed because they are used by the business, but they both can't be called active customer, okay? So you've now got to come to a consensus. You've got to say to the marketing team, okay, and the digital team, sorry, you both use the term active customer, okay? You both can't use it. We need to come up with unique terms for each of you. So you might decide for marketing, people who transact are actually customers. So therefore, they're valid to call active customers. Whereas people who log in may not be active customers, they just might be active users, active accounts, whatever. Okay, but come up with a different name. So therefore, in your first column where you talk about the KPI metric, they're unique. So you're not replicating them across, you're not replicating the KPI across the document. They're unique in the document. If you can't come to a consensus because, for example, the digital team, their SaaS solution that records, like for example, they might have a tool like digital, Google Analytics that records it as active customer or active user, whatever, and it clashes, we think they can't change it, okay? What you're saying to them is, look, in your system, it's fine to be called whatever it is, but when you present it to the business, you need to call it what we've agreed in the data glossary, okay? Now, sometimes the systems may dictate what you call it, so therefore that needs to take precedence. Sometimes it may not. Sometimes it may be the case that a term makes more sense to the business than what your system calls it. So you just need to acknowledge that and move on from there, okay? So try and get to some level of consensus within the organization. If you get to a point where departments aren't agreeing to it, you need to create some kind of committee and form a consensus. And then what happens is that when you form this consensus through a committee, even the team who hasn't agreed to it for whatever reason, if they go around presenting the metric that they shouldn't be presenting in that name, in the name that they use, then the senior leadership will go, hang on, why are you calling this active customer? We know in the glossary active customer is defined like that. This is not active customer. And they'll get pushback, and then eventually they'll learn that they have to use the terms that are in the data dictionary. And it's all about using a common language within the organization that doesn't lead to any miscommunication or confusion, and people are able to use the right numbers for the right reason. Once you've created your data dictionary and you've formed consensus and you've sort of handled those disagreements by creating a committee and making sure that people at the top are using the data glossary consistently, you now need to make sure that this data glossary is updated all the time. Now, there's several things you need to take into account. One is, how do you make the document a living document? Now, one of the things that I do is put it in a cloud-based system. So I use typically Google Docs because, or Google Sheets actually, because my organization uses the Google suite of product. But it could be, you know, online Office 365, Word doc on OneDrive. It can actually be something like Confluence in Atlassian software. It can be any online documentation software. It doesn't really matter. As long as you're able to keep a version control and you're able to control who can access and who can actually contribute or edit the document. So what I normally do, and what I would recommend, and I talk about it in my book, is that you have a small team of people, a small group of people, representatives from each of the departments or the main department, and representatives from the data team who are able to edit the document. So what may happen is that a new metric is introduced to the business, you form, your little team gets together, you agree what it is, and then you update the data glossary, okay? Or it may be the case that there's a metric that you don't want to use anymore and you need to delete it. again, the small team decides that and you delete it. You don't have to meet, you can agree these things on email, on Slack, whatever communication you want to do, and then you just delete that, okay? So first of all, you've got to make sure it's a living document with version control, as we talked about in the beginning, okay? So now that means that that document is now accessible. The second thing is that document needs to be related to the app output or the activities that will improve data literacy. And one of the common way of that, one of the common forms of that is reports and dashboards. So when you send out reports and dashboards, you need to make sure that people understand the numbers and how to read them correctly. And for that, they need good data literacy. So what I would suggest you do is that you either attach the glossary to the report and send it out. And a lot of organizations, even though they have the ability to send links to reports, so for example, they might say, here's the Power BI dashboard, here's the links to it, management, and especially senior leadership, don't like to click on links and log in and view the report. They want it as a PDF or some kind of a document that they can just download on their email and look at. Now, if that's the case, you want to attach the data glossary to the report if it's actually an attachment. However, if it's an online report where they can log in and look at a Power BI dashboard, then you can just put a link from the Power BI dashboard or the Tableau dashboard to your data glossary, and they can see the most recent version of the data glossary, okay? So work out how it works best in your organization. Make sure the document's a living document, that you're reviewing it. I would typically have a monthly meeting or a call with all the representatives just to make sure that there's no new metrics being introduced into the organization, and you amend and append or add when you need to. Okay, so now you have your data literacy, your data glossary, you know what to include in it. Like I said, the four columns, the KPI metric, the explanation, the example, and then the alternative uses or names for that KPI. You're going to make it a living document. You've come up with your processes to get agreement and consensus on what those are. You make sure that everyone's using it. Okay, so now you have this document, you've got to make sure that the data team are the ones who also maintain it. Because if the data team doesn't follow the data glossary, there's no reason why the rest of the organization would do that either. So it's very important that the data team are very consistent with the language that they use, that it reflects what's in the data glossary. Now, in my book, Data Culture, which is available on Amazon and also on the publisher's website, Kogan Page website, I actually provide a template for the data glossary so you can have a look at what it should look like, and I give some example metrics and KPIs so you know how to fill it in. Okay, well, thank you for watching the video. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, please do like and share the video. Of course, like I said, there's a link in the description about where you can get my book from, so please do go off and get the book on data culture. Thank you.